steadfast through every trial, the ageless rock of Christ. Almighty refuge of endless love through every changing tide. You are faithful. Will endure.
to rescue us with arms outstretched upon the cross. The greatest gift there ever was of love and kindness. How great is your love and kindness, O God of goodness, our joy forever to sing the glad.
Welcome, everybody. It's so good to see you here this evening. We have got a packed room and there's people still coming in. It's wonderful to have you here with us for week two of the Keswick Convention. My name is Jodie and this is Martin and we are trustees here at Keswick Ministries. And you can probably already tell where I'm from. So I'm from Liverpool. I'm a northerner. Martin, where are you from?
Well, I'm from Bedford, which is... nobody knows where that is, really. It's sort of... Is it the Midlands? Is it south? Is it east? It's kind of an hour north of London, if anyone's interested.
Okay. Well, I thought this evening we'd see where we're all from. So, give us a cheer if you're from up north.
Not bad.
Give us a cheer if you're from down south.
Ooh. Better.
Very good. Give us a cheer if you're from somewhere in the middle. And give us a cheer if you're from anywhere else.
Okay. Not bad, not bad. I think, I dare say, I think the Southerners might be winning in enthusiasm so far.
Possibly. Maybe we can try again tomorrow.
We'll try again tomorrow. You've got all week to correct it, Northerners. Last week, week one, was a great week. We had lots of people really engaging with the ministry online. Whether that was sharing things or commenting, we would love that to happen again. There's a number of ways you can do that. On the screen there, you can like the page on Facebook, you can use Instagram, you can use follow on the YouTube channel. If you're watching online, you know, all of this is free there on catch up as well. Use the hashtag KezConv22. Now, we would love to see, like, if you're here and doing things this week, we'd love to see some pictures. If you are sat in a spa in Saudi Arabia, we want to see the pictures. If you're following, having a barbecue in Sydney, like, let us know. We're all one in Christ Jesus, and we really want to try and create that atmosphere. So whether it's pictures, comments of things you're enjoying, send those in to us, and we will share a few each evening.
It's great to have with us Ben and the band, so thank you for joining us this week. And before we begin tonight and we worship God, let's pray together. Let's pray. I will extol the Lord at all times. My praise will always be on my lips. My soul will boast in the Lord. Let the afflicted hear and rejoice. Glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. Lord God, we come to you this evening and we thank you that you are our great God. You care for us deeply. You love us beyond we can ever imagine. We thank you that we can come here this evening and lift up your name. We praise you for who you are and what you've done for us through Jesus. We pray this evening that our hearts will be drawn closer to you, that our love for you will grow deeper. We thank you that your word is going to be preached this evening, and we pray that you will change our hearts to become more Christ-like. So we lift this evening to you now. In Jesus' name, amen.
God's word says, come. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth and the mountain peaks belong to him. All that you've seen driving in today belongs to the Lord. We're going to raise our voices in worship of him, our great God. Let's stand together.
Consider all
my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul.
Do please take your seats and wow, you're in great voice. What a privilege to get to be together, to join our voices in praise like that, isn't it? Are you sure?
Yeah.
Great. Every year, every week of the convention, somebody from around the area comes to give us a welcome, which is lovely. And this year, it's a real privilege to be able to welcome James Newcomb, who's the Bishop of Carlisle. And I'm going to hand over now to Bishop James, who will welcome us. Thank
you. Well, good evening, everybody. As you've just heard, my name is James Newcomb. I'm Bishop of Carlisle, but rather confusingly, live here in Keswick, so about 5 minutes' walk from this tent. And it's a particular pleasure for me and a real privilege to be able to welcome all of you, wherever you've come from, north, south, middle, and elsewhere, to Keswick, from all of us who live and work in this town. Many of you will know this part of the Lake District already very well, probably. For those who don't, we like to think that it's one of the most beautiful spots on earth, and it's not always raining. Very glad also to be able to claim a very special connection with the Keswick Convention, because we live in an old vicarage right next to St. John's Church up at the other end of town. And the convention began, I wasn't there at the time, it was about 150 years ago, on the lawn of the house where we now live, because I gather that the vicar then was looking out of his window. He looked at the lawn, he thought, we could put a tent on there and we could do some Bible teaching. Why not? That's where it began, and now look at us. The lawn would not accommodate everybody who's here this evening. But it's also a real delight to be able to welcome you on behalf of all Christians, the church, the Christian church here in not only in Keswick, but also throughout Cumbria. We like to call ourselves the ecumenical county because, as we heard earlier on, we are all one in Christ Jesus. And we work together insofar as we're able with a shared vision, which we call God for all. God is for everyone in Christ. And we have four great themes: follow daily, which is all about discipleship; care deeply, which is all about our care for one another and our neighbours; speak boldly, which is about our evangelism and witness; and tread gently, which is all about the environment. And I know that all of those themes will be touched on in one way or another during this coming week at the convention. And I hope and I pray very much that everybody here, all those who will be coming during the week, will find your own faith and discipleship deepened, and that will build on the wonderful work that has taken place during these amazing Keswick Convention weeks over so many years and for so many people. So may God bless you very richly indeed, and thank you so much for giving me this opportunity to say hello.
Isn't it brilliant that we're all on one site this year? And just seeing this room full is wonderful. And I just want to remind you that we do have neighbours who are living close by. So what I'd ask is, please be friendly to our local neighbours. Go out your way to talk to them, to say hello, to just be a shining light in this community. And what I'd ask is, each evening, I'm saying this to me as much as to you, when we leave, can I ask that we leave quietly at the end of the night? Because as you can imagine, 3,000 people leave in one venue, it can be quite noisy. So we're just asking if everyone can just be quiet as we leave this evening. It'll just help us when we're building relationships with this local community.
Yeah, we'd encourage you to, as Bishop James encouraged us, we want to tread lightly. As Jody said, we want to be a shining light. We want to be a blessing in this place, don't we? And we'd encourage you to shop, you know, use the shops, use the facilities, places to eat, cafes, all sorts of different shops and businesses. We'd love you to go in, to spend money there, to support them, to take something of the fragrance of Christ in our interactions with the people around the town. If you want to find out more, there's an Enjoy Keswick website, which has info about businesses and activities around Keswick. And while you're here as well at convention, if you have any questions, if you need any assistance with pretty much anything at all, we'll see how far we can push that, ask any of the welcome team. They would be delighted to help you this week. Well, we're going to stand again, and Ben and the band are going to lead us in another song.
Let's stand together. Who is heaven?
Has no one living with sound? Kings and nations tremble.
Father, we adore you, and we thank you for all you are to us in Jesus. We behold you and give you glory in his name. Amen. Amen. Let's take our seats.
Well, if you don't know already, on our website you can find our convention programme and you can download it and keep it on your phone. And on there is all the information about every event that's happening this week. And also, as you've come in, you've probably seen that we've actually got the programme on huge big boards as well across the site. So please do look so you don't miss out on anything that's happening. We've also got our live stream on YouTube, and you can also click on that link from our website. So from those who are watching us at home, you're most welcome here this evening too. And you can catch up on most of what's happening through our YouTube channel as well. So after this week, when you go home, please do go back and have a look and maybe share the link with your friends and family.
Now, is anyone here new? Is this the first convention for anybody? Yeah, there's a few hands up. Well, there's something tomorrow for you. Sunday, that's tomorrow. It is Sunday tomorrow, isn't it? It's been a long travelling day. 2 o'clock tomorrow in the Pencil Factory. That's just the big building out there. Second floor, room 2. There's a welcome reception for you to come along to and to find out a little bit more about the convention and the programme this week. There's also this week a program. If you are 19 to 24, give us a cheer. Excellent. Now, there's a program running for you as well this week. That's also in the Pencil Factory, second floor, room 3. There's morning get-togethers, Monday to Friday, 9:30 start. And there's also an evening program, starts tomorrow. That runs Sunday to Thursday, 9:15 p.m. start. All the information is on the website. You've no need to book, just turn up. A great time is guaranteed. Now, we're going to hand over to, there's a few other people going to come up and introduce various elements or aspects of the convention this week. So first, Matt Holden is going to come and talk about children's and youth programmes.
Good evening and welcome. We're so excited to welcome you here to Week 2, especially if you're under the age of 18. So if you're under the age of 18, can you give me a big shout? If you're under the age of 18, can you give me a big shout? Okay, there's not many here tonight. Great. Okay, just a couple of notices about the children and youth work. So if you've registered online already, then you will need to collect your wristband. And this is happening tomorrow in various venues that you can find either online or in the various boards around sites. And there's two opportunities to do that. First at 9:15 till 9:45, and then 10:45 till 11:15. And so that's before and after the all-age service. If you haven't had a chance yet to register, there are still some spaces, but spaces are limited. So if you want to register for the children and youth work, then you can head over to reception and they can help you out. Or if you have a smartphone or a laptop, then you can do it online. But we're really excited to welcome you to Week 2, Children and Youth.
Hello, I'm Karen from All Nations Christian College, and we are facilitating the base camp, which is just next door. In our venue, we have a magnificent coffee shop and a bookshop, which Jonathan will talk to you about soon, as well as a relay venue and a space for seminars. We have many exhibitors there, from all different mission organisations who would love for you to come and talk to you about what they get up to and how you can get involved. Come and see what God is doing in the world, on your doorstep and far afield, and see what you can do to get involved, whether that be on your doorstep or across in a different place, so you can pray or give or go. Thank you. We look forward to seeing you in the base camp.
Hi, folks. We've been learning in our church at home about a wonderful verse from the Bible. Behold, what manner of love it is that we should be called the children of God. And that is what we are. And one of the great privileges of being children of God is that we can pray to our Heavenly Father. We have access to Him. He hears us. when we pray. And prayer is an enormous part of the ministry of the Keswick Convention. And so let me share with you just in 1 minute what is available for us all. For the joys and for the sorrows, for the challenges and for the conundrums, we can pray together. Every weekday morning, starting on Monday, in the building next door, the old packing hall, will be a prayer meeting at 8:45 till 9:15. What a great place to start our week and our day at Keswick. Come and join us. If you can't come every day, plan to come one day to pray for that half an hour. Then at the end of every main meeting here, there'll be an opportunity to share and to pray that something on your heart, something that you've been provoked with in a talk, or you've come to Keswick and there's something you really need to deal with, and by committing it to the Lord in prayer, we'd love to pray with you as a prayer team. And you can see there's a prayer area after the main morning and main evening sessions. We'd love to see you. And if that doesn't work for you, do get in touch with the office of the Keswick Convention. We can book in and schedule a time where we can meet to pray with you that's really convenient. Prayer is where it's at. We're looking forward to seeing you at those meetings. Have a great week.
Yeah, evening everybody. My name is Jonathan, and it's my pleasure and privilege to be part of the team that are running the bookstore just through in Base Camp, just down here. About the fifth puddle on the left, you'll find the bookstore. And it's run by 10ofthose, 10ofthose.com. Our passion at 10ofthose is to handpick the best books from across the publishers. We road test them, and we know that they point to Jesus. And then to get as many out as possible, it's our firm belief that as books point people to Jesus, they can totally change your life. I know that in my own reading, and I hope you know that in yours as well. I think a lot of people say, oh, this will change your life, this will kind of change everything. But it's true, on the way in, this true story, a lady grabbed me, and I was keen to keep walking because it was raining. She grabbed me and she said, I bought a book last year from you, gave it to a friend, and during the course of the year as she read it, she gave her life to Jesus. Books that point people to Jesus can change your life. So this week, get something good that's going to point you to Jesus, and we'll be praying. It will change your life. Now, we handpick it all. We discount it, so there's some amazing deals. And then with the profits, some companies, they like to send their owner to space. We don't do that. With the profits, we... You work out who that is. Anyway, never mind. But with the profits, we like to support missions around the world, both Keswick here, but then other missions around the world for those who otherwise couldn't afford it. So throughout the week, both morning and evening, I'll be recommending books that we love, that we want you to get hold of and use for yourself, but also to get and give away and pass on to friends. Let's kick off with a pack that we're going to put together. We've got four books from Keswick Ministries that we'll do all four for 15 quid, which is a pretty good deal. So you've got the Undated Devotions that Elizabeth McCoy puts together for Keswick. You've got one on holiness, you've got one on hope, and one on love. I think the greatest of those is love. And then you've also got... I've been working on that all day. No, I haven't. I wish I'd... Never mind. Anyway, moving on. You've also got the Grateful Study Guide, which is a great way to perhaps use during this week. There's 7 studies in there, so you could work through it for this week. But then consider how you as a church family might be able to use them once you get home. So get the pack, 15 quid. We'll see you down there. We want to get you good stuff that will point you to Jesus. And who knows, just like that lady this last year, might just change your life. Thanks, Jody.
One of the reasons that the Keswick Convention is so brilliant is because it's a free event. And we want this to continue to be a free event because we want anybody to be able to walk through the door and to sit under the Word of God. But obviously, to put on such a big convention over 3 weeks, it does cost quite a lot of money. It costs about £120 per person to put on the convention. But because we don't charge, we're able to open it up to people who may not be able to afford to come to a convention like this. And the only way we can do this is because of the amazing generosity from our supporters who give while we're at the convention, but also who give monthly throughout the year. So can I thank you for those who are able to give to the Keswick Convention? And can I ask you throughout this week to prayerfully consider how you may be able to give to the Keswick Convention? At the back of the halls, these envelopes, and in them is information on how you can financially support the convention and our all year round ministry. So please do take one of these envelopes. You can fill in a form and you can put down how much you'd like to give, and then you can pop it in one of the boxes at the back or give it to reception. And you can also donate online. So if you go onto our website, you'll also find a donate button where you'll be able to give so we can continue to run the convention as we do. So please do prayerfully consider how you can support the Keswick Convention this year. And now I'm going to pass back to Ben, who I believe is going to teach us a new song.
We are going to learn a new song. In a few moments, we're going to be hearing from Psalm 95, and it says this: "Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care." One of the privileges of being God's children, being in his flock, is that we can come to him in all our mess and all our imperfection and be met with grace. We're going to learn a song that helps us to confess to the Lord our sin and be reminded of the grace that he shows us. It's called Confession Song, and it goes a bit like this. I'll sing you the chorus, and I'll invite you to sing it back. The chorus goes like this. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. How I need your grace to know. Though my sins are red as scarlet, wash them whiter than the snow. Should we try that together? Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. How I need your grace to know. Though my sins are red as scarlet, wash them whiter than the snow. Wonderful. The verse goes like this. Lord, have mercy on this sinner for the sake of your great love. Wash away my great transgression, all the wrongs that I have done. Let's try that together. Lord, have mercy on this sinner for the sake of your great love. Wash away my great transgression, all the wrongs that I have done.
Let's sing the chorus together.
Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. How I need your grace to know. Though my sins are red as scarlet, wash them whiter than the snow.
Wonderful. I'm going to invite you to stand. We're going to go from the beginning together.
Thoughts
I try to hide for the promises I've broken, for my weakness, for my pride. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. How I need your grace to know. Though my sins are red as scarlet, wash them whiter than the snow.
Praise God for that truth. Please do take seats. In our evening meetings, as a theme for the convention, we're thinking about the theme of gratitude. And for our evenings this week, we're going to be in the Psalms with different speakers. And in just a moment, Tim Chester, will be well known to many of you, will come and preach. But before he does, Matt Searles is going to come and read the Bible. And as he does so, Matt, just tell us something about yourself and what you do.
Hi, I'm Matt, so part of the Southern team winning the shout-out, I think. I work for Crosslands, an organisation we help train people to understand the Bible better, particularly equipping people for church ministry, not getting people to come to us, but enabling them to study and train to work for churches where they're based. So that's my day job currently.
Great. And you're not only speaking, you're also running a seminar stream this week. Tell us a little about what we might expect in that.
A seminar stream, Grateful for God's Word, a Bible overview. Many people may have done a Bible overview, so you see how the whole story of the Bible puts together. But if you haven't, three things I will be praying that we will take away from these times. Firstly, seeing just the beauty and the coherence of God's Word. One story telling the story of His plan of salvation in Christ Jesus. What a thrilling thing to see what God is doing, and that's what a Bible overview helps us see. Secondly, seeing Jesus Christ in all the scriptures. We know Jesus tells us the whole Bible testifies to him. But if you're anything like me, there's parts of the Bible we find that straightforward, other parts somewhat harder to see the links, perhaps some of the Old Testament. And so we'll be thinking how we can perhaps see those unfamiliar books, perhaps those less known parts, testify to our glorious Savior. And thirdly, I pray it will help us understand any one passage of the Bible as we see how it links together with the whole. So I hope every time we open God's Word, as we have a sense of the whole, that will help us understand any one passage better.
Brilliant. Well, as you read and as Tim comes to preach, let me pray. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for your Word. We thank you that it is living and active, that it is a light unto our path. And so as it is read and preached, would you give us soft hearts? Would you open our ears and our eyes that we may behold wonderful things? More than that, we would behold you this evening. In the precious name of Jesus, we ask it. Amen.
Let's hear God's word from Psalm 95. Come. Let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all other gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth. The mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it. And his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care. Today, if you would only hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as you did at Meribah, as you did that day at Massa in the wilderness, where your ancestors tested me. They tried me, that they had seen what I did. For 40 years, I was angry with that generation. I said, They are a people whose hearts go astray, and they have not known my ways. So I declared on oath in my anger, they shall never enter my rest.
Thank you very much. Good evening. Welcome to the Keswick Convention. Are you ready for a break? Well, about two of you are. Well, that's the rest of my talk scuppered already. I wonder if you've had a tough day. Perhaps you've been kind of battling through the traffic to get here with the kids moaning in the back seat. And you arrived, you've found your accommodation, perhaps you've put up your tent in the rain, you've shoveled down some food, and now you're slumped in your seat, hoping that tomorrow will feel a little bit more restful. Or perhaps you've had a tough year. Perhaps you're feeling the cost, the rise in the cost of living, wondering how you'll heat your home this winter, readjusting after COVID. Maybe your church is full of tensions as you kind of make that transition. Maybe you're worrying about war in Europe. And with all that's going on, you're hoping that this week will be a little haven of rest. Well, the good news is that our psalm this evening is an invitation to rest. In fact, it's an invitation to find rest through gratitude. Rest through gratitude. That's our theme, enjoying rest by giving thanks. And we start with a call to come before God with thanksgiving because God is God. Come with thanksgiving because God is God. Look at verse 1 again. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. Come before him with thanksgiving. That's the call that this psalm makes to us. And it's a call to make some noise. And we've begun to do that this evening, to sing, to make music. And we're given a reason. Verse 3 begins with the word for. Come with thanksgiving for, because. Here's the reason. For our God is a great God. He is the God who made all things. From the lowest, the depths, to the highest, the peaks, the mountain peaks. Just over here on my left is Skiddaw. You can sort of look at it as you leave. God made it, and it is his. Or think of Derwent Water, and perhaps that's too shallow to count as the depths, but God made it, and it's his. Verse 5 says, he made the sea and formed the land. Well, that's everything covered, literally. The psalmist goes further. God is not only a great God, he is the great God. Did you notice that in verse 3? Verse 3 says, he is the great king above all gods. There are lots of gods, sort of inverted commas as it were, things that have a hold on us, that influence us, that shape us. But only God is the God. Only God is the true God. Every time we worship, we're making a choice. The choice to worship one thing is a choice not to worship something else. And I wonder what that means for you today, this week. What that's going to mean as we come together and we worship God. What is it that you're not going to be worshiping? What is it that matters most to you? What is it that you want to shout about today? What are you going to stop worshiping that you might give yourself to the worship of the Lord Jesus Christ this week? God is the one who is above all gods, above whatever it is that claims your allegiance. This week is an opportunity to kind of recalibrate. You know, every time we turn on the TV or we check our social media or we talk with colleagues, we're presented with the claims of other gods.
with all the seductions of this world, all the pressures of life. It's very easy for us to get sucked into other priorities, things that we want or things that we fear. Let this week be an opportunity, as it were, to step back and ask yourself, what really matters to me? Who is truly great? Who has the power to protect, to satisfy, to save? Let me encourage you for 1 week to forget about all the things you might want and come before God with thanksgiving. For 1 week, forget about the things that you fear and come with thanksgiving. And let's sing and shout about our God. Let's find rest by trusting in the God, the great God, the God who alone can protect and satisfy and save. And maybe, who knows, what we may find that sense of resting in God this week, some of that may carry on into next week and the week after with all the challenges that they bring. You know, preachers are supposed to illustrate their sermons. I can do no better than to invite you as you leave the tent this evening to look to the mountains and say, you see that mountain? My God made that. Or if you're watching online and you live near the shore, go and stand by the sea and say, the sea is his and he made it. The greatness of God is on display all around us in this world, this wonderful world that he has made. And it is his gift to us. Every mountain is his gift to you. Every fun time that you'll have this week is his gift. Every meal that you enjoy, it is his gift. Let us come with thanksgiving. Every moment this week that you go, wow, that is God's gift. He alone can protect and satisfy and save. Let us come with thanksgiving because God is the God. And then secondly, let us come with thanksgiving because God is our God. In verse 6, we have another exhortation to come. It's actually a different word, slightly different word in Hebrew. Come in verse 1 has the sense of go to. Here in verse 6, it has the sense of come in, enter. So verse 6 says, come in. Let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. Perhaps the original worshippers, the original singers of this psalm were processing into the temple, coming into God's presence. And so the mood changes. Instead of shouting, now we bow down and kneel before God. It's as if as we enter God's holy presence, a reverent hush descends. And again, we're given a reason to come with thanksgiving. Verse 7, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care. Now it's personal. He's not just the God, now he's our God, the Lord our Maker. I think there in verse 6 is not so much the Creator God as the Maker of his people, our Maker, our Redeemer, the one who has redeemed us, who has gathered us, who has covenanted with us to be our God. God not only makes the world, he remakes us as his people. He not only performs wonders, he performs wonders for us. We are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care. It's personal. We are under his care. You are under his care. Now think about that for a moment. I don't know what problems you've left behind as you traveled here, or what problems perhaps you've brought with you. But I know this. If you're a Christian, then you are safe within God's care. He holds you fast. The Lord Jesus is your good shepherd. And our good shepherd feeds us. He feeds us through his word. He brings us into his pasture, says verse 7. And it may be that God has led you to the convention this week, to the pastures of his word, as it were, so that this week he can feed you, nourish you, nurture you. So remember, verse 1 is come, as in go to. Let's go to Keswick. Let's see the mountains and give thanks to the God who made them. Now in verse 6, we come in, we enter. Let's enter the convention tent. This is the pasture land where God, our God, feeds us through his word. This week, let's come and be fed by the good shepherd. Let's come with thanksgiving, because God is the God, the great God, the true God. And let us come with thanksgiving because God is our God. He is our maker. We are the sheep of his pasture. But then thirdly, let's come with thanksgiving because we're very easy to be ungrateful. We're urged to come with thanksgiving, to come with gratitude, because we're in danger of being ungrateful. Look at the second half of verse 7, if you've got your Bibles. Today, if only you would hear his voice. And then we hear his voice. Do not harden your hearts as you did at Meribah, as you did that day at Massa in the wilderness. All the noise of verse 1 has faded away. Instead, we're called to listen. A somber mood falls over the psalm. Why this change of tone? The answer is it's so easy for us to be ungrateful. And so we end with a kind of case study in ingratitude. These verses talk about a particular day in the history of Israel, an event that took place at Meribah and Massa. It's actually the same place. And we read about it in Exodus 17. In fact, if you were here last year in week 2, you'll remember that we looked at these in the Bible readings, that passage. So here we are, picking up where we left off. The Israelites are in the desert after being rescued from Egypt, and they grumble because there's no water. They quarrel with Moses. And in Psalm 95, we kind of get God's commentary on that story. Look at verse 9. Your ancestors tested me. They tried me, though they had seen what I did. So the people of God had seen the wonders of God. They'd seen God rescue them from Egypt. They'd seen him lead part the Red Sea and lead them to safety. They had seen God provide manna in the wilderness. And it seems that that wasn't enough. That was yesterday, and this is today. And they're so focused on their need that they forget about God's provision. Grumbling replaces gratitude. They were ungrateful. Now, there is a place for coming to God with our pain. We don't have to pretend we've got everything together when the reality is we're falling apart. The Psalms often sound a note of lament. But lament turns to God, not away from God. Lament comes and speaks to God. It doesn't, as it were, talk behind God's back. And lament comes to God in faith. The very act of coming with all that pain and confusion is a sign of faith, a faith that God hears and cares, even if all our circumstances are painful. But ingratitude is different. Ingratitude turns away from God. And that is serious. It is not a small thing. Verse 9 says, or God says, they tried me. That is, they put me on trial. An ungrateful heart says, God is letting me down. He is being unfaithful. He's at fault. We put God on trial and we make our judgment against him. He's in the dock, we're the judge. But our judgment against God rebounds on us. It demonstrates our lack of faith in his care. And those who grumbled there back in there in the wilderness, those who grumbled didn't enter the land. A whole generation died in the wilderness. Look at verse 10. For 40 years I was angry with that generation. I said, they are a people whose hearts go astray, and they have not known my ways. Astray there, maybe a bit of a pun. It's elsewhere it's translated wandered. They wandered in the wilderness because they wandered in their hearts. They went astray in the wilderness because they went astray in their hearts. Verse 11, so I declared on oath in my anger, they shall never enter my rest. In the end, ingratitude is a lack of faith. They had seen what I did, says verse 9. They had seen the same mountains that we see. They had seen amazing acts of deliverance. But they have not known my ways, says verse 10. They didn't recognize God as the God. They didn't see God as their God, as our God. They were not able to enter because of their unbelief, says the writer to the Hebrews at the end of Hebrews 3. But then in the very next verse, it's as if the writer of Hebrews picks up the end of this psalm. In the very next verse, he says that the promise of entering that rest still stands. Today, if you hear his voice, you can enter that rest. You can enter that rest through faith. There is hope and there is rest, even for ungrateful sinners. The people put God on trial, says verse 9. And in Exodus 17, that is exactly what happened. Do you remember this from last year? God arranged a courtroom. Moses was there as the judge. He's holding the staff of judgment that had kind of brought judgment on Egypt. He's there in the middle. The people of God, represented by their leaders, are on one side. And then God says, I will stand in front of the rock. So here are the people of God. They are guilty. They deserve to be condemned. Here is God. He is innocent. He deserves to be vindicated. And here is Moses acting as the judge with the staff of judgment raised. And then it falls. But in a glorious, gracious kind of twist in the story, it falls on the rock. God says to Moses, in that moment, God says, strike the rock. The staff of judgment falls on God. And that rock was Christ, says Paul in 1 Corinthians 10. That rock was Christ. Ultimately, the judgment of God, the judgment of God's people, the judgment that we deserve falls on Christ at the cross. The rock represents God stepping in to shield his people from his own judgment by bearing it in our place. And that rock was Christ. Do you notice where the psalm begins? Verse 1, let us shout aloud to the rock. To the rock of our salvation. The rock who comes between us and God's judgment. Of all the many reasons we have to give thanks to God, top of the list is that the Lord Jesus Christ has borne the judgment that we deserve in our place so that we can come before him with thanksgiving. What overcomes our ingratitude is God's generosity, God's grace, God's goodness. And that we see that all around us, but more than anything, we see it at the cross. That rock was Christ. Psalm 95 doesn't really have a conclusion. I think it ends rather abruptly. Verse 7, I don't know if you noticed this, verse 7 says, if only you would hear his voice. And then in verses 8 to 11, we hear God's voice, but there's no response. We're kind of left with that word, if. If you hear God's voice, if what? Then what? What happens next? The response is left to us, to you. Today, you can harden your heart, or you can soften your heart, humble your heart. Today, you can nurture your grumbles, or you can come with thanksgiving. The writer of Hebrews says, there remains then a Sabbath rest for the people of God. Let us therefore make every effort to enter that rest so that no one will perish by following their example of disobedience. There is an eternal Sabbath rest for all who come to Christ. If you put your faith, if you put your trust in Christ. But there is also rest in this life. You will find rest this week if you let God be God. If you let God be the God. If you let God be your God. It's rest by being grateful for who God is. Rest through gratitude. The alternative, the other option, is to be your own savior. Try and sort out your problems by yourself. Try and establish your own identity. And the problem with that is every problem we solve is replaced by another. If we're trying to establish our own identity, then you are only as good as your last performance. We become like a dog chasing its tail. We can't pull it off. And we can't solve those deeper problems of sin and death. However hard you try, you can't be your own savior. It will drive you, it will make you weary. And you don't need to be. You don't need to be your own savior. Why not? Because God is good at his job. God is good at his job. He is the great king, says the psalm, and he can bring order to your chaos. In his hands are the depths of the earth, says the psalm, and in his hands are the depths of your fear. We are the flock under his care, says the psalm, and he cares about whatever is on your heart this evening. He is God, and he is good at his job. He is our Redeemer, and he is good at redeeming. So rest. This week, rest. Rest not because you've left your problems behind for a week. Rest because you are leaving your problems in God's hands. You may find it helpful to kind of think of handing them over to God in prayer, maybe even, as it were, holding them up in your hands to him. As we close, I want to talk to three specific people here tonight. Now, don't worry, I've made them up. Okay, they're not real people. But then maybe they are. Maybe you might find a bit of yourself in one of these people. First, there's Anna. Anna's past is messy. We don't need to go into details, but it feels to her like her past sticks to her like glue. You know, sometimes when you're trying to wipe glue off one hand, you just end up getting it on the other hand. That's how life feels sometimes to Anna. And so she comes to the convention weary. She tries so hard to be a good Christian. But whatever she does, it never feels enough. And tonight, Anna, God says to you, I am your rock. I have come between you and my judgment. You don't need to make yourself good enough. I have forgiven you and cleansed you. I am the rock of your salvation, and I am good at my job. Then there's Brian. Brian is a self-made man. He got where he is today through hard work and initiative. He's proud of what he's done with his life. But Brian comes to the convention weary. Throughout the pandemic, he's been running to stand still, trying to keep up with rising prices, trying to hold it together, worrying that he might have to rely on others. And tonight, God says to you, Brian, I am your maker. You were never a self-made man. Humble yourself, kneel before me, and then step into my care. Don't worry about being self-made. Just be Brian. Just be a child of God. I am your maker, and I am good at my job. And then finally, there's Colin. Hello, Colin. Colin helps run the youth group in his church, and he loves doing it. But he just feels so inadequate. The youngsters are facing issues of sexuality and gender, issues that didn't even seem to exist when he was young. And in a few weeks, his eldest daughter starts at secondary school, kind of going into that world of moral confusion. And so he comes to the convention restless. How is he going to sort out his young people? How is he going to protect his daughter? Tonight, God says to Colin, I am your shepherd. And I am the shepherd of your youth group. In my hands, I hold the depths of the earth, and in my hands, I hold you and your family. Protecting people and redeeming people, that is not your job. That's my job. And you know what? I am good at my job. Anna, Brian, and Colin will find rest by being grateful for who God is, the God, our rock and our redeemer. If there's a little bit of Anna or Brian or Colin in you, then let me end with two very practical steps you can take that will help you to find rest by being grateful. We find them in the two commands in this psalm. First of all, come and sing. Verse 1, come let us sing for joy to the Lord. We get something similar in verse 2 and verse 6. Come and sing. If you want to find rest by being grateful, come and sing. Let's join together and remind ourselves who God is as we sing together. Remind ourselves what he has done in a way that captures our hearts. Come and sing. And then secondly, come and listen. Verse 7, today, if only you would hear his voice, come and listen as God's word is preached, listening out for the voice of God, for his promises, for his reassurance. This week, let's come before him with thanksgiving, and maybe we will find rest through gratitude. Let me pray. Father, we thank you for the mountains that surround us here in Keswick and that remind us that you are the God who is above all gods. We thank you too for your word and the opportunity that we have this week to be fed by you, to hear your voice as your word is taught. Father, our prayer is that this week, as we gather together weary and restless, we would find rest as our faith in you is strengthened, as we let you do your job of being our maker and our redeemer, our rock. And each of us with all sorts of different issues, we pray that as we come and connect, as it were, with some different facet of who you are and what you've done, we would find rest, not just for this week, but for this year. Rest, because you are our God, our maker, our rock, and our redeemer. Amen.
Come, sing for joy to the rock. Let's stand together.
Every blessing to my heart. To streams sing your grace, streams of mercy never ceasing, called for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious song sung by flaming tongues above. Praise his name, I'm fixed upon.
Seats. Isn't it great to be together again? Tomorrow, there's a whole load of things going on. If you're looking for a Sunday service at one of the local churches to attend, there's information about those on the website and also on the info boards on your way out. We'll be in here at 10:30 tomorrow morning for the all-age service. I should have said earlier as well, the welcome reception tomorrow afternoon isn't just if it's your first time, perhaps if you're here on your own as well and you'd like to meet some people, that would be great for you to attend as well. Tomorrow evening, we're recording the BBC service, so we'll be in here, but we'll be starting just a little earlier at the time of 7:15. So do please try and be here on time, 7:15 tomorrow as we do that.
We've also got our prayer team available to pray with you tonight if you want to respond to the preached word. Our prayer team will be just to the left and to the right of the stage here, so please do come forward if you want to pray with somebody this evening. And if you're watching online and you have a prayer request, then please do send it in to us at prayer@keswickministries.org. And then also, every day this week, we're going to be having a prayer meeting, which I believe is the engine room to the Keswick Convention. And that's at 8:45 a.m. at Base Camp. So please do join us in prayer each morning.
We've had a great encouragement, haven't we? A great start to our week, that encouragement for us that we would learn more this week to rest. To rest in gratitude and to have weary souls refreshed. Let me pray for us as we close our first evening together. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. And Father, we've just begun to do some of that this evening. And as we do more of it this week, would you teach us to rest? Would you teach us more of what it means to be rooted in you, to be resting in our gratitude towards you, to see more of who you are, to love you more for all you've done. Teach us more about these things and bless us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by